So we start with the with graphical models themselves. So why using graphical models? Because they simplify a lot implementations and finding long-form expressions for some particular problems. Instead of doing algebraic manipulation like I done here in the blackboard, this is doable for a small system. When you have a visual inertial system with 10,000 images, it's obviously impossible to unthinkable to do something like that. So we use graphical models for simplification and also as the easiest way to transform the human expert knowledge into a computer program, so to say. We will see that. So what is a graphical model? The definition. A graphical model allows us to represent a set of random variables and their conditional independent assumption. So this is the key. We have a number of variables. That is nothing new. Everybody knows the problem that you have in your mind. You know the variables, which variables you have. But the key is, how are all these variables and their versions over time relate to each other? That's the key for me, the independence assumptions. It was the graphical models literature was born as a fusion between probability theory and graph theory. And this is one of the reference books, the one for Bishop from Microsoft. A classification or taxonomy of graphical models. Obviously, if you look at the state of the art, you have mixed models everywhere. But the basic classification would be like this. You have Bayesian networks, which are directed graphs. So it's a graph with directed edges. The version with dynamic variables, dynamic Bayesian network, DBN. Then we have undirected graphs, which are Markov random fields. And finally, a kind of graph that is different, which is a factor graph. This is the one that is most interesting for us, I think, because it has advantages for implementation. It is really straightforward to have a graph and implement it into a computer program. Actually, they are already their libraries that do that. So, much better for us. So, the purpose of using a graph. A probabilistic graphical model provides us a mechanism to describe complex densities, complex joint distribution. And basically, this is the key, by exploiting the structure in them. We are not talking about 10,000 variables, but 10,000 variables that are connected in a very particular way. They allow for efficient factorization, so efficient thinking of inference estimation. So the edges are important, but the lack of them is even more important because we want normally to have the less edges, the better. In any graph, the sparser, the better. And we will basically use for inference, but in other fields, they use graph models for other problems. For example, for sampling. If you want to draw samples from a very complex distribution for simulation, you may use graphical models. So the first kind, all of them are important. The first kind of network is a Bayesian network. A Bayesian network is a directed, acyclic, graphical model. So you cannot have loops, okay? And it is have directed edges. And the nodes represent variables. So you have variables, entities that are, some of them are known to you and others are unknown. But all of them are nodes, the same kind. And you have edges between them. And the most important thing here in the entire course, this talk, is I want you to get only one idea is this, that the edges have a meaning of causality. So A arrow to B means that A has to do, it is the cause of B, influence into B. Okay? And that comes from a, it's a way of encoding a human expert knowledge. Obviously, there are algorithms for trying to recover Bayesian network from data, but for us, in our kind of problem that I think you are maybe interested, you are already the expert in some problem and you want to encode that information into a graph. Okay? And this is a, this gives you a huge advantage for making making calculations on that basis. Once you have a Bayesian network, the joint distribution of all the variables can be split into this, into the product of in a set of conditions, conditional distribution. For each variable I, you have the conditional probability of xi given the parents of that variable, basically. So, an example. Did you understand it? If you have a lot of variables, the factorization of this is the product of all the six independent variables given the parents. Okay? So let's do that as an exercise here. Well, by the way, this is a simple model of a car, of for making it's a toy model for playing to make reasoning about why the car start or doesn't start. So you have here F means that the car has full, is filled with full. G means that it was refilled. G means that the car has gas. Okay? These are variables that may be true or false. So each one may be assigned a probability between 0 and 1. Okay? If they are discrete events. B means that the batteries are okay and they work. They are charged. W means that the car starts. And A means that the audio works. So this is a toy problem, but I think that if you follow, you may agree with the arrows, probably. So if the batteries work, and it depends on whether the batteries work, that the car can start and the audio works. So for example, imagine that the car doesn't start, but you can hear the audio. That has information about B. Okay, if you only observe A and W, you can infer information about B. If you know that the car was refueled, you know something about G, and so on. That's the idea, to infer information from connected variables. So, let's try to write this factorization. So it will be the probability of A, B, G, W, F. So, tell me, what should I write here? Do you want it? It should be the product of, give me one variable to start with. Pick one.
F or B, for example. If? Are independent. Exactly. So I can multiply F and B because they are independent. Yeah.
Exactly. Pick the probability of F goes as a marginal. It is called, we will call it later a trio. It's like something that has, it doesn't have a parent. Okay, so it goes like that. Perfect. So let's follow G. The probability of G.
G given F.
Given only F, exactly.
And W given G and given B. Given G and B.
Exactly.
And A given B because it's the only parent of the A.
Exactly. And we have five variables. We need, there's a missing one, B.
Okay.
Which is B of B given nothing because it has no value. Okay. So from here to here, we have probability distribution of dimensionality 6, 5, sorry, and here we have 5 much smaller functions. It is far more convenient to work with. And also they have a meaning. I mean, each of these terms have a meaning. For example, let's say probability GF. How likely it is for the car to have gas if it was refilled? Well, you can invent some kind of function that depending on the time, the day after refilling it still has gas, and the probability will decrease with time or with distance, whatever. Okay? So, these are functions that you have to make up with some kind of model. Any comment or question? Okay, did you get the idea of what is a Bayesian network? It's easy. So the next concept is basically just the same. It's a dynamic Bayesian network. It's the same, but with variables that change over time. So you have to specify how the variable for one time step modify the variables in the next time step. Normally, the states x is classically in control. You know, the state in the new step equals the last one plus something, plus the action, something like that, right? So the state depends on the last state, and only the last state. Okay? This is a way of graphically specifying the Markov property. Do you know what is the Markov property of stochastic processes? The Markov property is that if I only know the distribution of the variable at one particular instant of time, I can forget about the past, because everything is summarized in this time. I don't mind the path that took me to this point. The important key is that I am here right now. The past doesn't matter. Everything is encoded here. Okay, and this is encoded here because there are no arrows that go from the past to the future. Okay? Here, by the way, this C are the observations. For example, if I have a car, this may be the position and velocity, and this may be the accelerometer. Okay? Or in a chemical plant, this may be the one sensor, pH sensor, whatever, temperature. This is a more complete example for a vehicle localization, for a drone localization, whatever. Here we have, by the way, the colors means observe and not observe. Okay, the gray balls means the variables that I don't know. They are the ones that I am estimating, and the white ones are the ones that I know. So the U means the action. These are the observations, and M is a map. Okay, imagine the scheme will be exactly the same, independently of. We using a LiDAR, radio range measurements, a stereo vision, whatever, a ground vehicle, a drone, whatever, exactly the same. Now, imagine, for example, that P, it may be, the observation for the radio vehicles. We have several, the map comprises like the set of some radio vehicles that are in the environment, and I know where they are, okay? And then C are the values of the ranges that my sensor is measuring. Like to station 1, I measure in 10 meters, station 2, 3 meters, okay? All these observations stuck together is C, okay? And they depend only on where the sensor is, where the robot is, and where is the map, the beacons, okay? So we can write a function here, the probability, the marginal, we write the marginal distribution of this network we end up having this term, the probability of the observation given the position and the map. Okay? And this is called the observation Bayesian model. Later we will see this converted into a factor graph. This will be a factor, a function. A function that specifies what is my prediction for the range given, assuming that I'm in some particular position. The range, the distance, the camera. You have to write a function that simulates something. Okay? And then it is compared to the real data. And if you estimating the robot position amounts to reducing the discrepancies between what is predicting each of the arrows, so to say, to maximizing the likelihood, to minimizing the discrepancy between the prediction and the actual observation. And also we have here the action. In this case, it will be a motion model. Each position in time has to do with the parents, where I was in the last semester, and what I have done in the middle. If this is a ground vehicle, it will be the odometry readings from encoders, for example. If this is, I don't know, the temperature of a tank, this will be the intensity of the heater, for example. This is your expectation about how the state will change. And then it is corrected with observation, of course. Everything is corrected with everything simultaneously. Okay, now we move to the Markov random field. It's another kind of graphical model. We will see this one very briefly. It is an undirected graphical model that may often even contain a lot of loops. The nodes again is exactly the same, each node is a variable, and the edges does not have information, high level information. They just mean that these two variables are somehow related. That's all. It doesn't carry any causality implications. There is no parent. Okay? We can convert any DBN into a Markov random field, but we are not discussing this here. This is an example. We have a lot of variables and they are all connected to the neighbor. So they are good to specify the spatial Markov condition instead of the temporal Markov condition. In the temporal Markov condition, we say that given that I know my current state, I can know the past doesn't matter. Okay? Here, the equivalence will be if I know about my neighbors, I don't care about what is happening outside. Okay, this kind of model was developed by physics, I think. By physicists in the early 20th century were studying atoms and crystals and this kind of thing. The factorization of MRF would be the product of all these functions here, which are an energy function for all the maximal clicks of the graph. A click in a graph theory is a subset of nodes in a graph that are connected with all of them with each other. That's called a totally connected graph. Okay, so if we take a graph and take the set of maxima, and the maxima means the largest subset that you can take, but it is totally connected. For example, if we had another edge here, the maximum click will be everything. Okay? So you take each of these maximum clicks and make a function for each one. And it can be used for application, it can be for many, many tasks, but one famous application is to noise removal, because you have to, this constraint here has information like, okay, I must be close to my neighbor. And in that link, you encode a function that imposes that neighbors must be similar. And if they are not similar, it's like a... You can think also all of these graphical model as masses and springs. They have a mechanical equivalent, actually. If you think of variables as a mass, and connections and arrows as a spring. Okay, and the larger the uncertainty for the of the arrow, you have a softer spring. Okay, if the spring is stiffer, if they have a larger stiffness, okay, then the information is larger. The stronger the connection, the stiffer the spring. Okay, and then you have like springs connecting the values of all the variables. Then, if you have noise, it's as if the springs doesn't allow the pixel to move too much of the neighbor, something like that. There must be like many points together to overcome the force of the spring. I think that is a good analog idea. Okay, and finally, we leave the third kind of glass, which is a photograph. Photographs are graphs with two different kinds of nodes. We have two different kinds of nodes. One kind is normally depicted like this, like large nodes, and they are variables. But we also have other smaller, these dots here, which are factors. So the elements in the graph are variables and factors. The variables are basically variables. They are values that you want to estimate or that you know. And factors are connections between them of some kind. We don't have arrows here. They are undirected edges. We only have and this is important, we can only connect a variable with a factor and a factor with a variable. We cannot draw edges between factors or between variables directly. It doesn't make sense. Okay? It's like two separate kind of elements, and you can only connect make connection between different kinds of elements. Okay? Probably it's easier to understand as the factors. Factors are like the one that impose constraints between variables. And we have many different kinds of factors depending on the energy of them. We have unary, binary, ternary. So we have factors, for example, this one. This factor over here is unary, because it only depends of one variable. And again, I have another factor, unary factor. Unary. Those. Okay? We may have binary, like this, basically the rest. And we may have factors that depend on the number of variables that you work. Okay? This particular problem, I will explain this, because we will use this graph, this picture a lot. It is taken from this Franderaer book, anyway. This is an example of a robot localization program. Okay, here the x1, x2, x3 are three different positions of the robot over time. Okay, and notice that we are not making filtering. We are estimating the whole history of the trajectory of the robot. Okay, so x1, x2, x3 are the positions over time. And L1 and L2 are the position of some landmark. For example, imagine that using a camera. And you are detecting a marker, for example. You have a reflective marker or whatever, and you put one marker at one position and one marker in another position. You have only two. And then you have, from the first position of the robot, you have one observation of the landmark number one. And only that. Okay? You also have these unary factors here that may be, for example, initial estimates about where your robot starts. Each factor may be, in the end, we will see that they end up being a function with an error function and an information matrix, assuming that they are Gaussian. Okay? So the stronger, we may have factors that are really strong and also that are weak. A weak factor has a very small information matrix. So it gives you information, but it's like a spring with almost no stiffness. It's like used basically to make the problem numerically stable, usually. Imagine that you don't have these two unary functions here, and you just try to estimate the position of the robot given these two landmarks and the observations, okay? Depending, it depends on the kind of sensor, but the problem may be ill-generated. You may need like to, okay, let's call the starting position 000, something like that, okay? To impose that, you may use a unary factor that gives the information that the initial position is at 000 arbitrarily, okay? But with an information matrix that is very, very weak. So, as soon as you have any other information from a real sensor, it will be discarded automatically. Not discarded, but it will be just overridden by other stronger sensors, so to say. I don't know if you are getting the analog with springs and sort of. Well, then here we have an observation of one landmark, and then the robot move in time. This factor represents the odometry. If the wheels, if I know that from one moment to the other the robot is supposed to have moved like 1 meter, for example, this factor introduces that information. It tells you the position of that robot position is 1 meter ahead of the former one. With this confidence, larger or smaller, depending on the terrain, on the robot, whatever. Okay? And then from that position, the robot again observes landmark number one. And then it moves again and observes a different landmark. Okay? These triers, what do you think these ones may be useful for?
The position of the landmark.
Exactly. Those may be like a wild guess of the initial position of the landmark, or they may be a strong conditioning the position of the landmark. Depending on how well do you know the initial position of the landmark. But if you have plenty of information, not like this, obviously, you will need like hundreds of observations. You may refine the position of the landmark and automatically get a better map simultaneously to get a good estimation of the trajectory of the vehicle. Okay. So, a lot to say about this graph. Any comment? So, as you can see, normally we will. One way of working with fat graph is like this.
Do you define the entire problem? Do you plan to extend to another physical problems, like non-intrusive load monitoring, for example? I think there is a strong relationship, and there are a lot of observations, states, and
you just need to think of the entities of your problem.
Yeah, I know.
What are these balls and how are connected to each other? If you can think about that and write a function for these factors, if we can think about.
I have appliance. And I want to know the states. That's the problem. Okay, we can talk about it.
So in theory, this can be applied to. Actually, after this came of the talk, I don't think we will start today, but we'll end up tomorrow. I have an entire section of the talk that is devoted to examples of factor graphs applied to mechanics, to robotics, to kinematics, to different problems, just to give you ideas of what kind of things can you do with this. Okay. So there is a bit tough, but I wanted to put it entirely as is. This is the algorithm, the method to convert a Bayes network into a fast graph. I think that's important because when you encode the information as human, expert, it's easier to encode that first, in my opinion, as a Bayesian network, because it has the concept of causality. It is the way we think normally. This causes this. So do you draw a picture of your variables, your causality relationships, and then you apply this to convert that into a factor graph, which is easy to implement, easier to implement in a computer. So basically, you can compute, the conversion is simple. Every base network node is split into a variable and a factor. And the factor is connected to the variable and the parents. So basically, each node in the base becomes at least a node and at least one factor. You may add additional factor later if you want. And then you connect the factor to that node and the parents. In some are evidence nodes, and they are given as node, we don't need the corresponding variable nodes. So if you have variables that you know, you don't have to add them as variables in the factor graph. We will see an example here. Okay. Here, again, it's like a slam problem. Here, X means the positions of the robot, L are landmarks or whatever, and in the environment, phi are observations. In the square, it's a base network with a square nodes, meaning they are evidence nodes. We know the phi. So, we don't know these variables to be in the factor graph. So let's try to reproduce here the transformation between them. At least a part. So we have x1. X1 is an unknown, okay? So I want it to be in my factor graph. X2 and X3, as well as the landmarks. Now, I must convert a fact. This set 2 becomes, it may be a variable if I wanted to estimate it, but I already know that, so forget about the variable. It becomes a factor. And the factor is connected to the parents of it. So I must connect the factor to L1 and X1. Exactly the same for F3. It's another factor. And X2 is split into a factor. X1 into a factor that is connected to the parent. In this case, X2, the parent is S1. And so on.
In this specific problem, where did you choose the landmarks to be unknown?
To be unknown.
To be a variable.
In this case, they are variable because we want to do a slam, to estimate them. Even if I have a little guess. If I already know them for sure, you just forget about this, and you will have just like this. Observation, like that. Everything will be unary factor. So, it's not only drawing the picture. Now, we want to implement this. What is the key here, thinking of implementation of a real problem, is identifying the types of factor and the meaning of a factor. What will be the function that we will have in each of these ones? So, how many different types of factor can I identify here? Well, I would say that this one, and this one are of the same kind. They relate states with map elements. So thinking of the problem of these being positions, and these are landmarks in the world. Your problem is maybe whatever. kinematic constraint, whatever. So in this case, this is an observation, basically. It's an observation of a landmark from the position. So it is a factor of the kind observation, f of. Here will be exactly the same, f of. And I need to write a factor that takes as input the position, the landmark, also as a parameter, the hidden variable that was here, which was phi2, phi in general, but this is a parameter that is fixed, it's a number, okay? And then I need to write this function and the derivative of this result with respect to the error with respect to x and with respect to l. I have to write derivative because of optimization. We will talk about that tomorrow, at least a little bit. So I need to specify this. And also, what other kind of factor do you see here?
Odometry.
Between S1 is this represents odometry, so it must be odometry. Exactly. You must write a function that tells me, given as a parameter the hidden node that was here in the base network, it's not here actually, but it's U1, U2, it is a parameter, the action of the robot. Given that action, give me a prediction of this one, of the second one, with respect to the first one. So I can compare that with the actual numerical values during the optimization, and I can use the Jacobians and optimize. Okay, so factor of odometry. And then I have these ones, right? These are called priors. This is a prior of type X, of type robot pose. This is a prior of type landmark. These are just very simple factors. Actually, it will be the first one that I will write. This is a factor. The factor ends up being an error function. And the error for the prior, x, for example, would be x minus my first estimation of the prior, something like that. The error is the value minus my estimation. So when the value is exactly what I want to be, it is equal to zero. That's the idea. So now that we have a fact graph, the name tells everything. Each factor becomes a factor in the factorization. Okay, that's where the name comes from. Each of the function of the factor, each of the dots, becomes a term in this product. You have to just multiply all the factors in the graph, each one depending on the variable that touches the factor. As simple. I was going to do that example, but we are running late, so I will skip. It will be just the product of f odometry of x1, x2 times f odometry x2, f3, and so on. So now that we have what is a factor graph, what can we do with it? Okay. We can do sampling, we can sample values, random samples. We can evaluate, which is the most important. We can evaluate this number, the probability of this hypothesis. Let's assume that my state is the probability, this number. Even with only that, you can just run a MATLAB brute force optimization and you will reach an optimal value. Okay, but they are a much smarter way to optimize. But the key is evaluation, being able of evaluating the length. So maximum a posterior optimization can be done with Gauss-Newton optimization. Normally this is the topic of PhD in robotics, so it is really getting would need to get to very low level details to get into something new in this topic. Everything here is very, very well studied by a really smart guy. But tomorrow I will give a very brief ideas of what is already implemented about it. But normally, I think that nobody here will work on this. Basically, you will use what is already implemented to write new models and to optimize new models, because optimization of factor graph is already a very well studied topic. Error models. Here are the what you have to write to define a new factor for a new problem. If you need a factor, you need to define the error model and a measure of uncertainty of that factor. How strong the factor is linked to the variables. Okay? The strength. More than strength, the correct word would be stiffness, actually. Stiffness of the spin. So the most common model that we will use most of the time is a Gaussian model. If we assume that the function, that the measurement that I am comparing to my model comes from a generative model like this, a function of x plus a Gaussian noise, and this Gaussian noise has a covariance matrix sigma, capital sigma, then the error has this form. This is the Mahalanobis distance from the prediction of my model with respect to my observation field. This double bar with the sigma here. This splits into this actually. It is a vector. This is a column vector. Transpose, it is a row. A row times the inverse of the covariance times the vector gives you one number. Okay, this is actually multiplying. This is a transformation using a quadratic form of the inverse of the covariance. It's the proper name of this. Okay, and what we are doing here is like scaling the errors. Each of the components of the error, we are scaling with the uncertainty, with the confidence that we have in our model. It's like normalizing the errors. We may have an error that is in whatever scale, but everything is relative to how much do we trust that function.
Okay. So Mahalanobis distance, Mahalanobis distance.
Exactly, that is exactly the Mahalanobis distance. So, and that's all. That's the basic model. Now, so to summarize, if you need a new factor for some problem, all that you will have to write is this error, this function f, actually, and specify the sigma. To start with, that's a good starting point. That's enough for start to work with this factor. Okay? But then we have one issue with outliers. Okay? This error function here is quadratic, basically. It's not the same that x squared, but it's almost the same. You have the same here is almost as x squared. Okay? So if you have only one error, it will one wrong data, it will ruin your estimation totally. Because the squared error very quickly grows. If you think as a parabola, okay, if all the data points are near the zero, and you have one of the data points that is far from here, the optimizer will move the parabola a lot just to make happy this bad guy here. Okay? So this is what is happening here. Imagine that you have all those points and you are applying factor graph to find the line. To find the correlation, to fit the line into a set of data. Okay? If all your points are those, you have this line. If you only have one outlier, it ruins. It gives you something that it is not even close to all of these guys. So it totally doesn't make sense. To fix that, we use what is called the ROAST kernels. Instead of assuming that the error is like this, is totally quadratic, we assume, okay, the error is quadratic, but, okay, if this is larger than that, something is weird. It's weird. Don't trust this data point. And the shape changes. So, for example, this is, I think this is the Haber loss function with different parameters. It's how much do you trust your parabola as soon as you get far from zero. From zero, from the error of zero. So to say, this parameter is the scale of the parabola. Okay, they are different kernels, they are tens of papers analyzing which one is better for computer vision for each problem. Okay, but basically, what I wanted you to know is that this happens a lot. And nowadays that we are in the big data age and everything, and we want to plug tons of data to an algorithm and it to work better. The more data, the better. It's true only if your method is prepared to cope these kind of things. For example, a neural network will identify this and probably overwrite outliers somehow. Probably nobody knows how, but somehow. But in model-based method, like graphical method, you have to explicitly enable a robust kernel. Otherwise, a single bad data point will get you a wrong result.